Macmillan Audio presents Starless by Jacqueline Carey, read for you by Caitlin Davies. Desert. Chapter 1. I was 9 years old the first time I tried to kill a man, and although in the end I was glad my attempt failed, I had been looking forward to the opportunity for quite some months. That is only natural, I think, when one is raised as I was. Although as I grow older, I am less and less sure what that means. All things proceed from nature. If one thing alters the course of another's growth, is that not yet within the accordance of nature? A vine trained to climb a trellis remains a vine. And I am Kai, and remain myself. Whatever that means. It is a good name. Strong and bold. A name like the sound of a desert hawk's cry. A fitting name for a child of the desert. A fitting name for a child whose destiny was determined by a single feather. But that is not the whole truth. And Brother San, who is our seer and the wisest among us, says truth must be laid bare, as clean as a corpse flensed to the bone by Parkun, the scouring wind. So, this was the truth as I knew it. 9 years ago, in the realm of Zarkum, such an event transpired as had not taken place for 150 years. At the precise moment that Nim, the bright moon, obscured Shahal, the dark moon, a child was born to the House of the Ageless, whose members are also known as the Sun-Blessed. The priestesses of Anamut, the Purging Fire, are great keepers of records, and the lore of the realm holds that when a child of the royal house is born during a lunar eclipse, so too is his or her shadow. I was not the only such child born at that precise moment. According to Brother San, the priestesses of Anamut spent almost a year consulting midwives across the length and breadth of Zarkum. In the end, they discovered 13 of us. Hence, the feather. I remember it. I do not remember the mother or father to whom I was born. I do not know if I was high-born or low, or if I was born to the fierce desert nomads who acknowledge no rank save that which personal honor won in their own vendettas accords them. Brother San does not know either, but he tells me that the priestesses of Anamut will have that information recorded in their scrolls, and I may seek it for myself when I come of age, if the sun-blessed princess who is the light to my shadow allows it. Perhaps I shall. Perhaps not. After all, does it matter? In the end, I was the one who was chosen. A feather. It took place in the portion of the Fortress of the Winds that we call the Dancing Bowl, although that I do not remember. I know only because I have been told. It is a hard, stony basin that the men use for sparring practice. There are 3 tunnels that open onto its sloping sides, and many more riddling the cliffs that rise to tower over it. High above the basin, there is a thin stone bridge that arches across it, nothing built by human hands, but a structure etched into being by Parkun the Scouring Wind some thousands of years gone by. I know it well, for I have crossed it many times. I felt its faint tremor beneath my bare feet. I have felt the wind tug at my garments, threatening to unbalance me. Ah, but the wind. I must learn to embrace it. And so I shall, for I am pledged to Parkun the Scouring Wind, and it is all because of the feather. I remember. I do. There were 13 of us, all babes. 13 carpets were laid on the floor of the Dancing Bowl. 13 babes were set upon the carpets. I do not remember that part, but Brother San has told me many times. It was mid-morning in high spring, and the heat would have been rising like an oven, only a slight breeze swirling in the basin. I could imagine it well. Atop the arched bridge, Brother San opened his hand and let fall a single hawk feather. When I close my eyes, I can see it still. Blue sky and a lone feather, a pale brown with darker brown stripes. I see it fall, drifting on the breeze, turning in circles as it falls. I see the breeze carry it west, then north, east, then south. I see the edge of the veins catch the light like the honed edge of a blade. I see the hollow shaft glow with a milky translucence. Brother San watched from atop the bridge. The figures of the other brothers and a cluster of veiled priestesses in their bright red robes dotted the tunnel mouths above the dancing bowl, waiting, waiting, to see where the feather would fall. Which babe would be marked by Parkoon's favor, chosen to be the shadow to the bright sun-blessed princess in the faraway city of Marabot. Along the walls of the dancing bowl, the families watched and waited to see who among them would return to their far-flung homes less one babe, bragging of the honor bestowed upon them. The feather drifted and drifted, circling down above me. I waved my hands in the air and caught it in one chubby fist. A great cheer went up. That, too, I do not remember. But I remember the feather. I have it still. And so it came to pass that I was raised in the Fortress of the Winds by the Brotherhood of Parkoon, raised to be a warrior. Of course, at 9 years of age, I was not yet fully versed in the traditional weapons of the Brotherhood. I lacked the strength to effectively wield the curved sword known as Yakan, or Windcutter, as well as a three-pronged kopar that served as a weapon of both offense and defense, but that, I was promised, would come in time. I was quick and wiry, hardened to the elements by going shirtless and barefoot in summer and winter alike, and I could take down a mountain goat with a single swift blow to the jugular with a slender dagger that had been given me on my 7th birthday. And so, when a caravan escorting a supplicant to attempt the trial of Parkoon appeared on the horizon, I begged to be allowed to take part. Understand that there was no malice in it. This was simply our way in Zarkoom. And indeed, I believe that there was both purpose and mercy in it. It was a harsh mercy, but then the desert is a harsh place. The nature of the trial of Parkoon was this. Any man convicted of an offense deserving of execution could choose instead to undertake the trial, upon which he would be escorted by the royal guard across the deep desert to the Fortress of the Winds. At the entrance to the fortress, which, like the bridge above the dancing bowl, is no man-made edifice, but a vast series of caverns and tunnels, the supplicant would strike the sounding bowl and announce his intention. To pass the trial, the supplicant had to do but one thing: make his way past three brothers in the Hall of Proving. If he succeeded in emerging alive into open air, he was reckoned scoured of his sins by Parkoon, accepted into the Brotherhood, given a new name and a new life. Very few men attempted this. Even fewer succeeded, for the fighting skills of the brothers who were born into this warrior caste and pledged to its service as young men, though none so young as I, were not only honed by decades of practice and centuries of tradition, but augmented by the skills of those few who did succeed. There was much debate around the supper table the evening before the supplicant's arrival. "Kai is young," Brother Drogen said in his slow, implacable manner. He served as cook to the Brotherhood, and although I was often grateful for his considered way, on that occasion it made me impatient. He glanced at me out of the corner of his eye, one corner of his mouth tugging downward in an apologetic grimace. "Let him be a boy while he may. It is too soon for him to wrestle with mortality." Brother Jowl made a lightning-quick gesture, as though flicking away a fly. "Are we raising a warrior or not? Death is no respecter of age."
"Therein lies my concern."
Elderly Brother Ahudin, who taught me my characters and numbers, knit his brow.
"What would come to pass if the shadow of the sun-blessed met an untimely demise?"
Everyone looked to Brother San, including me. Brother San's face was tranquil. He was old, too, older than Brother Ahudin, although it seemed to me that age had visited him in a different way. There was nothing crabbed or querulous about him, only a deep stillness none of us could yet emulate.
"Kai might die in a dozen ways in our care before the princess comes of age," he said mildly. "One wrong step in the heights, and he would plunge to his death. We cannot allow that fear to hobble us." I stifled an indignant protest at the notion that I might perish due to a careless misstep. Brother San's gaze rested on me.
You are eager to undertake this challenge.
I placed my palms together and touched my thumbs to my brow in a gesture of respect. I am, elder brother.
Then it shall be so, he said. On the morrow, Kai will take the third and final post in the Hall of Proving.
My heart quickened. Thank you, elder brother.
It is no gift I give you, but a grave charge, Brother San said to me. Tomorrow, a man's life hangs in the balance. It is Parkun who decides his fate. Know that you are but an instrument.
I touched my brow again. Yes, elder brother. Brother San's eyelids crinkled.
What is a warrior's first and greatest weapon, young Kai?
It is his mind, elder brother, I said.
Very good.
Rising from the table, Brother San laid a hand on my shoulder.
Conduct yourself with honor.
I inclined my head.
Always, elder brother.
My sleep that night was restless. I rose at dawn to offer my prayers in the privacy of the small cavern that was my bedchamber. 4 genuflections for Zar the Sun, Nim the Bright Moon, Shahal the Dark Moon, and Eshin the Wandering Moon. 2 genuflections for Anamut the Purging Fire, and Parkun the Scouring Wind. And at last, 4 genuflections for the 4 great currents, East, West, North, and South. Brother Jowl poked his head in the opening of my cavern.
Are you done? He inquired.
Come, let's get a look at this supplicant. I scrambled to my feet.
Yes, brother.
Atop the western lookout, the wind was brisk and buffeting. I stood beside Brother Jowl, knees flexed to maintain my balance.
Let your mind be like the eye of the hawk.
So Brother San had taught me. I gazed at the party making its way toward the Fortress of the Winds. 6 men in the crimson and gold silks of the royal guard, riding hardy, sure-footed steeds. 1 man in the center of them, a portly fellow clad in rich brocade robes, 7 purses, and a longsword with a gem-encrusted pommel dangling from his waist sash. Their shadows stretched westward behind them. Brother Jowl made a disparaging sound.
A merchant, he said in a dismissive tone. Soft and rich. Like as not, he'll try to bribe us.
I was shocked. Is that permitted?
No.
Brother Jowl shook his head.
But that's the way city folk are.
I supposed it must be true. And I shook my head too at the folly of city folk.
To think that one could bribe us.
It made me wonder, though, what the princess would be like. I thought of her often, the light to my shadow. It was the first time in recorded history that a daughter of the Sunblessed had been born with a shadow. Zaria was her name. All of the Sunblessed bear the name of the sun in their own names. Zaria of the House of the Ageless, the 17th child born to His Majesty King Azarkal, who had reigned for 300 years, the 3rd child born to his 5th wife. Sunblessed, because Zarkum lies the farthest east of any nation beneath the starless sky. The House of the Ageless, because the sacred Rhamanthus seeds that are quickened by Anamut, the Purging Fire, bestow great longevity upon its members. These things I knew because Brother Ehudin taught them to me, but I could not imagine what such a person would be like. I knew the desert and hawks and wind. I did not know cities. I imagined there must be color, a great deal of color, like the silks the royal guards wore, or like the robes the fat merchant wore, all blue and green with gold stitching, robes that were wholly unsuited for the desert. As they drew near, I saw that he was sweating in the heat, the poor foolish fellow.
Why would he wear such garments?
I asked Brother Jowl. He shrugged. He was desert-born, a son of one of the nomadic tribes, and pledged to Parkun's service by birthright, not trial.
Among the city folk, such garments indicate wealth and status.
I squatted on my haunches, leaning over the ledge of the lookout. I wonder what his crime was. Brother Jowl shrugged again.
Whatever it was, he'll meet his final judgment today.
Or not, I reminded him. He laughed and caressed the hilt of his yakan.
Oh, I think a mighty wind is coming for this fat man, little brother. I've been given the first post.
I glanced over my shoulder toward the east. Beyond the peaks and valleys of the Fortress of the Winds lay the deepest desert. It was the domain of the sacred twins, for there Parkoon stalked the sands, raising them into a killing gyre as tall as mountains, blotting out the sky. There Anamut strode veiled in sheets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.